study. So 2 Samuel 8, verse 15. So David reigned over all Israel, and David administered judgment and justice to all his people. Joab, the son of Zeruiah, was over the army. Jehoshaphat, the son of Ahilud, was recorder. Zadok, the son of Ahitub, and Ahimelech, the son of Abiathar, were the priests. Seraiah was the scribe. Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, was over both the Cherethites and the Pelethites. And David's sons were chief ministers. Now David said, "Is there still anyone who is left of the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. And so when they had called him to David, the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" He said, "At your service." And then the king said, "Is there not still someone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God?" And Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan who is lame in his feet." And so the king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "Indeed, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lo-debar." Then King David sent and brought him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lo-debar. And now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, had come to David, he fell on his face and prostrated himself. Then David said, "Mephibosheth?" And he answered, "Here is your servant." And so David said to him, "Do not fear. I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake, and will restore to you all the land of Saul, your grandfather, and you shall eat bread at my table continually." Then he bowed himself and said, "What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" And the king called to Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, "I have given to your master's son all that belonged to Saul and to all his house. You therefore and your sons and your servants shall work the land for him. And you shall bring in the harvest, that your master's son may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's son, shall eat bread at my table always." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "According to all that my lord the king has commanded his servant, so will your servant do." "As for Mephibosheth," said the king, "he shall eat at my table like one of the king's sons." Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. And all who dwelt in the house of Ziba were servants of Mephibosheth. And so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he ate continually at the king's table, and he was lame in both his feet. Just on a personal note before I get going, I guess kind of two thoughts. One is some time ago when a man by the name of Mahmoud Ahmadinejad came on the scene in Iran, and it looked like he wasn't going to go anywhere fast. It was like, man, I got to figure out how to say this guy's name. And there was a little trepidation in doing that. And then, you know, the Lord reminded me that I'd learned how to say Mephibosheth. And so I could pull off Mahmoud Ahmadinejad as well. And it's funny just the way the Lord stretches you. I remember when we first got to Florida and started attending a Calvary Chapel there. They were doing a Sunday and Wednesday study, and then they were doing a Sunday evening service, and they soon discontinued that for other things. But I remember coming there and having no idea that the Lord was going to call me to pastoral ministry. And one of the first Bible studies we were in, one of the Bible college students or staff pastors there, I can't remember, he taught on this area of Scripture. And I remember being fascinated that for an hour he could say Mephibosheth's name and never mess it up. And I don't know if I'll be able to do that or not. But it was like, wow, that's incredible. If I could ever, you know, be able to teach the Bible and say that name like that. So it's kind of those funny things that hang in your head as you take a look at the Word and you make your way through the chapters. You know, you always kind of know chapter 9 is coming. And it is, it's like, Lord, prepare me, you know. So, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. So anyway, if I could draw your attention back to 2 Samuel 8, verse 15. So David reigned over all Israel, and David administered judgment and justice to all his people. Notice here in chapter 15, we see And we talk about this kind of a culmination of what's we've been looking at in chapter 7 and 8 last week. And we get an understanding of what's going on within David's kingdom. Notice as we take a look at it here, first of all, that David reigned. It was David who was reigning. David is now the king. There's no other discussion or communication about any other one else wanting to be king or anything else going on. David has solidified and affirmed his rule here within Israel. He is reigning. And notice that the text is clear when it says David reigned over all Israel. The idea that's being communicated to us is that David is reigning over all the 12 tribes of Israel. They are all following him. Now notice that the text tells us that not only did David reign, but David also administered. It's one thing to be a king, it's one thing to be a leader, it's one thing to be the boss, but if you don't know how to king, if you don't know how to lead, if you don't know how to boss, you're going to end up with a big mess. You're going to end up with anarchy. You're going to end up with confusion. Maybe some of you have worked in companies at some point in time where, you know, the guy who's the biggest slacker but can talk the best ends up being the boss. And so he's got the position of being boss, but he has no clue how to administrate anything. And there's a frustration that sets in for employees because they're wanting to be led, they're wanting to be coordinated, they're wanting to have a course set, they're wanting to have administration take place, and the person that's in the position to do that, well, they don't have those tools. David, he's not only reigning over all Israel, but he is also administering, and look at this, he's administering judgment and justice. So David is one who's willing to pull the trigger. David is one who's willing to make the decision. David is one who's willing to make the call. David is one who's willing to put in place structures and plans and designs that help things function within his administration, such that there would be judgment, decisions being made, but there would also be justice. Things would be done fairly and properly and in a good order. And we, of course, would want to say, and we would know because it's David, things being done in a way that honors and glorifies the Lord. And this really is something that we yearn for. If we take a look at just the events this week as we watch what happened out in Boston and this sort of thing, we wanted there to be judgment. We wanted there to be justice. We wanted to see administration. When we saw 9,000 police officers in riot gear descend on a town of 32,000 people, you were very glad that there was order there. You know, that there's somebody who was executing judgment and justice, and there was administration happening in that place. And they're brought to us, maybe as we looked on, or brought to those certainly that lived there, a sense of a security. There wasn't resolution to the issue, but there was a sense of security that things were in order. But the sentence, the verse that we're looking at, it isn't finished. A couple little pieces yet on the end that make it even sweeter. David not only reigned over all Israel, and he also administered judgment and justice, but look at this as well, to all his people. There have been a lot of kings, a lot of rulers, a lot of potentates and prime ministers who've been really good at reigning and administering judgment and justice to the people of their tribe, or to the people of their race, or to the people of their socioeconomic status. This is one of the problems that we see in Syria. Bashar Assad is part of a tribe within Syria that is a minority. And the fear is, and the reason that he's fighting tooth and nail the way he is, for him to lose just doesn't mean he loses and, well, hey, they get a new president or dictator or whatever he is. But his entire tribe could be wiped out because they're so small. And they have been the beneficiaries of his largesse, of his blessing in abundance for so many years. The people in his tribe, they come first. Saddam Hussein did the same thing in Iraq. He took care of his people, those that were related to him. He didn't take care of all the people. And this tells us so much about David, that David, as he is reigning, as he's administering judgment and justice, that he's doing so to all of his people, to all the focus being. But then look at the last little phrase. Not only does he do this to all, everybody is the beneficiary of David's rule and reign, but he does this Notice it doesn't say for the people. It says for his people. Gang, as we find ourselves in positions and places of leadership, whether it's as a mom or a dad, whether it's as a pastor or an elder, whether it's as a boss or a team leader on our job site or a Bible study leader or a playgroup leader, when we're in those positions of leadership, to be those individuals who rule and reign, if I can put that in quotes, you know, reign and administer judgment and justice to everyone, but then to notice, to our people, there to be that ownership that's there. He did all these things to his people. This would be the same David who would have written in Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake," and so forth and so on. This is that David that is administering the nation of Israel, giving judgment and justice to everyone, to those that are his people. This is David, the little shepherd boy. He started out caring for that flock of sheep, and when the bear came against them, when the lion came against them, he would wrestle them, he'd sling a stone at them, he would protect his sheep at all cost. And we continue to see how these formative years for David, as he was as a shepherd, as he was on the run from Saul and had this little band of men that were attached to him, that this would bring forth the fruit that when he would become the king, he would rule, he would lead, he would guide everyone who were his people. But there's one thing also that I want us to see about this as it relates to David and the type of king that he was. David was a good king. He was a good king because he did bring victory over the surrounding nations. That's what all of chapter 8 was before we get to this verse that we looked at last week. So he's a good king in that he brought victory over the surrounding nations, but he was also a good king because of his administration of judgment and justice to his people. It's not enough to just win the battles. It's not enough to just keep out the enemy. You also have to lead and care for the people that you are protecting in that regard. Mom and Dad, it's not enough to just keep out the filth on television. It's not enough to just put the filters on the computer. It's not enough to just assess and evaluate who are my children playing with and what are the influences that are coming into their life at school and through friends and through other social media and this sort of thing. It's not enough to just have victory over the enemy. There also has to be leading in the home, administering of judgment and justice. And this is totally an unplanned point that the Lord has just placed in my head and my heart. But Mom and Dad, if you would please focus on that concept of justice. Your children are looking to you to be just in the decisions you make. It's not just to be, well, the one who happened to get caught, or the one who cries the loudest, or the one who always seems to be the one that gets picked on, that it ends up being the one who's the winner. There is a responsibility before God as you lead and guide your parents to execute justice for your children. That you are the one who's to bring light. You're the one who's to bring truth. You're the one who's to bring a yes, yes, and a no, no into the life of your children. It's not just the one who's the quickest to cry. It's not just the one who screams the loudest. It's not the squeaky wheel that gets the grease, Mom and Dad. But you are representing God to your children. That means you ask questions, you evaluate, maybe you cross-examine to get to the bottom of what is the truth, what happened here. You know, because one child messes up, that doesn't mean all six kids get spanked. Now, what is that? See, Dave, there's so many things that we can learn from him. He was a good king. He not only brought victory over the enemy nations that surrounded them, but he administered judgment and justice to his people. And look at this, beginning in verse 16 through 18, we'll just kind of read down through it. We see his administration, how he put things together. Everybody has a job. There's team leaders. The responsibilities are divided. People are put in places where their responsibility for their gifts and their calling can best be used. Joab, the son of Zeruiah, he was over the army. Joab was commander-in-chief. He was the four-star, five-star, I don't know how many stars there are, but, you know, many-starred general. You know, he was the top banana, if they even had bananas there, I'm not sure. Joab, he's commander-in-chief, we'll stick with that. Little bit of sleep, whole lot going on this week, so we're doing our best. Jehoshaphat, the son of Ahilud, was recorder. There's some discussion about what this role is, but the common definition I was able to come up with on studying was, like, he was the public relations person. One book said kind of like a secretary of state, person that goes out to other countries, and when visiting dignitaries come, you know, just kind of handling that business of the realm as it relates to how we interface with the nations that were around us, and of course all of that is recorded and noted and this sort of thing. Zadok, the son of Ahitub, and Ahimelech, the son of Abiathar, verse 17, were the priests. And Seraiah, he was the scribe. A scribe in this case would be like a royal secretary. This would be an important role. This is a person that logs everything that the king does, all the decisions that he makes. This is how we can go digging now these days in Israel and in Iraq and in Syria and these countries, and we can find in Egypt, and we can find clay tablets that have been written on in the style of writing of that day that talk about the court of the day and the decisions that were made and the contracts that were entered into and the business that was taken care of. This scribe would have had the ability to read and to write and to do mathematics, would be a very intelligent person for the time, so he was a secretary. Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, was over the Cherethites and the Pelethites. Now, these people are not Israelites, of course, as we see with their name there, but these are people that have attached themselves to David, people who are from outside of the kingdom, who are God-fearers, who also love David, and this is his bodyguard. We might say, like in our day, our verbiage for today, we call them like the Secret Service of David's day. They watched out for him, they took care of him, they protected him. And notice this finally, David's sons were chief ministers. Chief ministers. Literally what's being communicated there is David's sons were at the hand of the king. At the hand of the king. And so David was an individual who he brought his family in around him to serve with him. We wouldn't want to charge David with nepotism in any way. As we would take a look at his administration here, everybody fits, everyone has a place, gifts and talents are used. And hey, you know what? If your family has the ability to serve alongside of you and they're gifted and talented for that, go ahead and do that. To be able to serve as a family together. It's huge. It's important. And it's one of the things we're going to see. We're going to come into coming chapters here where David's family really starts to feel the effects of some fractures and some difficulties and some challenges. And yet here at this time, yet David's sons are able to serve alongside of him. It's a great picture for us of serving in ministry together as a family. You know, you got five people in your family and say one of the children serves in ministry and no one else serves in ministry as well, it's going to be really tough for that child to get to church on time, to be able to serve, or to be able to get to that outreach. It's going to be a battle because nobody else is doing that. But if the whole family is serving together, we'll see for David with his sons right there by him side, father and son, here we are, ruling and reigning and working together in ministry, right? They're doing it for the Lord. This is the nation of Israel. So one of the things that we see then as we make our way and we conclude this particular small section speaking about David's realm is that we see he's reigning, we see that there's administration, we see that there is order, we see that there is structure. And this is a very good sign for us. We want to remember that David, a man who has a heart after God, that David is a type and a shadow of the Lord, but David is also one that we can look to as Christians, and we can look to his model, and we can learn from his life. And we see that as David takes over from Saul, as David comes into ruling over the nation of Israel, he brings this order, he brings this structure, he brings this administration to the nation, and this is huge. And the spiritual applications are huge as well. One of the things that comes into the life of a Christian, once they come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and once their sin has been taken away, there's a setting in order, there is a structure, there is an administration that the Holy Spirit brings into their life. Now, if you were to stop by my house and take a look at my workbench or maybe look in my garage, and you were to see a lack of structure and a lack of order, you might be prone to think, oh my goodness, Pastor Tom isn't saved. Look at this disaster area. Isn't he the one that preached about structure and order and this sort of thing? The issue is structure and order and administration in the issues of one's life. See, as Christians, when we are being led by the Holy Spirit, when we are following God our Father, when we're being led by the Good Shepherd, there should be an element to our life that is that there is this structure, that there is order. These are indicators of our growth and our walk in our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. As the Holy Spirit comes in and sets things in order in our life, to be a Christian and have your life continually falling apart, to be a Christian and be continually in a state of drama, to be a Christian and continually just be, you know, totally frazzled out and freaking out and just all over the place and just crazy, there's a problem with that. There's a problem with that. Because to serve the Lord, well, he is the Prince of Peace. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Following the Lord and being led by the Holy Spirit, there is a structure and a blessing that is there that should be evident in our lives, in our dealing with the things of life, in our dealing with people in life, and dealing with the issues of life that come in around us. And the condition of your workbench, that's a whole other discussion apart from a Bible study. So, 2 Samuel 9, verse 1, we read, "Now David said." Now David said. We remember back, if you want to look there, you can, 2 Samuel 7, so just two chapters back, we read 2 Samuel 7, 1, "Now it came to pass." Now it came to pass when the king was dwelling in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies all around, that the king said to Nathan the prophet, "See, now I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells inside tent curtains." We see there that in 2 Samuel 7, the desire for David is he wants to do something for God. We looked at that last week and we took that apart and made application for that. He wants to do something for God. But now as we cross into chapter 9, verse 1, the desire David has is to do something for others. See, the passage that we just looked at, chapter 8, verses 15 through 18, that's very important because as David has things in order there, as he's administrated judgment and justice, his perspective can be to look to the things of God and to look at and to look to the things of others around him. Because there is structure, because things are in order, because things have a place, because the Lord, through David, has organized those things that are around them, David has the freedom, the ability, the opportunity to go, look at this, I'm dwelling in a house of cedar, but wow, the Ark of the Covenant of God, it's just dwelling there in a tent. We got to do something about that. And of course, we know how that story ends. Hey, you're not going to build me a house, God says, I'm going to build you a house. That's last week. But this week, David's attention, again, still working from the structure, still working from this order. Well, David, what can I do for somebody else? I like that. And I think that there's something extremely special when we can be in the middle of a storm that comes our way, and in the middle of our storm can still have that perspective that goes, you know what, I have a storm going on in my life, but because the storm is happening in the middle of, well, what is administered and what is structured and what is decent and what is ordered, hey, while I'm going through the storm, who else can I help? Who else can I minister to? And we will see that evidence in David's life in just a couple chapters as well. So David said, verse 1, chapter 9, "Is there still anyone who is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" That I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake. And I'll read to you from 1 Samuel 20. Jonathan and David, they're seeing each other for what will be the second to the last time. They're making a covenant and an agreement with each other. And Jonathan said to David, And you shall not only show me the kindness of the Lord while I still live, that I may not die, but you shall not cut off your kindness from my house or from my progeny, from my descendants, forever. No, not when the Lord has cut off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth. And so Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, let the Lord require it at the hand of David's enemies. Now, because we've already read this, through this, we already know how the story ends, right? Is that David starts out here, hey, is there anyone I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? And we know that Mephibosheth is going to come to the surface, and that's going to be who David is going to show kindness to. And yet, back in 1 Samuel 20, when Jonathan and David make this covenant with each other, Mephibosheth isn't even born yet. And yet, he is the beneficiary. He is included in this covenant that these two men make. He, Mephibosheth, is unaware of it. He doesn't know that this conversation ever happened between his dad and David. But David remembers. F.B. Meyer writes, nothing in the course of events could alter the sacred word that David had sworn to his departed friend, referring to Jonathan. Our own case is similar. We were chosen in Christ before the world began, predestined to be sons, included in the covenant between the Father and our surety, referring to Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1 verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. So what happens here is that Jonathan and David have made an agreement, and now see these number of years down the road, this agreement, this covenant is going to come to fruition, and Mephibosheth is going to get to be the beneficiary of it. Jesus Christ, the Lamb slain before the foundations of the world, was entered into a covenant between Jesus the Son and God the Father, and you and I are the beneficiaries of that covenant, and we were not there when it was made. And so too, the heart of David says, I want to show kindness for Jonathan's sake. Jonathan, who my heart was knit together with him, my friend that was closer than a brother to me. I want to show kindness. Well, verse 2, there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. And so when they had called him to David, the king said to him, are you Ziba? And he said, at your service. And then the king said, is there not still someone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God? Now we get some further insight into what's happening here. How terrible would it be if David was of the persuasion that was like, I cannot believe it. I made this covenant and this agreement with Jonathan, you know, so many years ago, and I don't know. Man, what a pain in the neck. I cannot believe I entered into that agreement. But you know what? People are watching me. I got to do something. So let's, you know, kind of like scour around and see if we can find somebody of Saul's house, you know, and I'll slap a blessing or two on him and just get this whole thing over with. But that's not the heart. David, he says, is there somebody that I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? And then as he speaks to with Ziba, he says, to whom I may show the kindness of God. So there's a parallel, there's an interconnectivity in David's heart. But wait a minute. Wouldn't we expect that from David? David, the man who has a heart after God, that when his desire is to fulfill an agreement that he's made with his friend Jonathan, that a heart that belongs to the Lord, that would be intertwined with that? Well, yes, of course. And isn't it true that this is one of the things that challenges our hearts and hurts our emotions when those that are our brothers and sisters in Christ, when they harm us, when they hurt us, what hurts is it hurts even more because, well, isn't God their Father? Haven't they been shown the kindness of the Lord as we've been shown the kindness of the Lord? Doesn't that hurt us even more? And how often do we say, but they're Christians. Why are they behaving like this? Why are they acting? Why are they hurting me in this way? I thought they loved Jesus too. See, here in this case for David, there's no hidden agenda. The issues of his covenant with Jonathan, they flow right into and they flow right with the understanding that he has of God. in God's kindness. Let me say to you that God had shown himself to be very kind to David, and David wanted to show God's kindness to somebody else. That right there is something to chew on. Each of us, we have experienced the kindness of the Lord, and God the Father sending Christ Jesus the Son to die on Calvary's tree for us and to take our sin, and not only to take our sin, but to give us eternal life. We have been shown the ultimate kindness. Isn't there then a kindness that should flow out of our lives to others? And not a kindness because we want something, not a kindness because we're trying to work in an angle, but a kindness because we've been experienced the kindness of God. I want to read to you some passages, and I've massaged verse 3 just a little bit, if that's okay. Because the text says, to whom may I show the kindness of God? And the linkage for me is one of the words that I love in the Bible is the word loving kindness. I don't know if it still works, but it used to be in Microsoft Word, if you typed in loving kindness, Microsoft Word didn't recognize that as a real word. I don't know if it still works that way or not. You know, Microsoft comes up with new updates about every other day. So, you know, who knows? But loving kindness is a word that we don't use very often. And yet, I believe that is what is being spoken of here as David has experienced the loving kindness of God, and his desire is to show that loving kindness to somebody of the house of Saul, somebody of Jonathan's family. So let me read to you. You can take note of these. Look them up later on your own if you wish. Psalm 40, verses 10 and 11. I have not hidden your righteousness within my heart. I have declared your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your loving kindness and your truth from the great assembly. Do not withhold your tender mercies from me, O Lord. Let your loving kindness and your truth continually preserve me. Psalm 40, verse 10 and 11. Psalm 63, we sing this one. Psalm 63, verse 3. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. The psalmist says that God's loving kindness, it's better than life itself. Or Psalm 103, verses 1 through 5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. And then finally, Psalm Isaiah 63, 7 and 8. Isaiah says, I will mention the loving kindness of the Lord and the praises of the Lord according to all that the Lord has bestowed on us and the great goodness toward the house of Israel, which he has bestowed on them according to his mercies, according to the multitude of his loving kindnesses. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not lie. And so he, God, became their Savior. David's motivation, kindness for Jonathan's sake and showing the kindness of God. And in Ziba, he said to the king, well, there is still a son of Jonathan who is lame in his feet. Who's lame in his feet? Well, how did he become lame in his feet? Well, in 2 Samuel 4:4, we read that Mephibosheth was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel, that they had been killed. And his nurse took him up and fled, and it happened as she made haste to flee that he fell and became lame. His name was Mephibosheth. So what happens is word comes from the front that Saul and Jonathan have been murdered by the Philistines. They've lost their life there in battle. And so the nurse takes 5-year-old Mephibosheth up in her arms and starts to run with him. And somehow, I don't know what happened, he fell. And in his falling, he became lame in both of his feet. Maybe both of his ankles were broken. Maybe both of his legs were broken. We don't know. But whatever it was, after the fall, before the fall, he was totally fine, totally healthy, no problem. But after the fall, He became lame in his feet. Now, why are they running? Why are they hiding? Well, we've talked about this before, is that when one king conquered another king, the conquering king, he'd wipe out everybody from the royal household. Didn't have to worry about them trying to come back and take over. And the thought was, is that now as Saul and Jonathan are dead, that Mephibosheth, well, he could be in line for the throne, and, well, David, he would come to the throne, and maybe he'd wipe out Mephibosheth. Maybe he'd kill him so he wouldn't threaten the throne. And so the nurse runs off with him to protect him. So this tells us how he came to be lame in his feet. So verse 4, 2 Samuel 9, the king, King David, said to Ziba, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "Indeed, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lo Debar." Lo Debar, the word, it means, the name, it means a thing of naught or a thing of nothing. Mephibosheth, at 5 years old, is living in the royal household. His meals are taken care of. He's probably beautifully clothed, even as a five-year-old living in the royal household. In the turn of events, the Philistines killing his grandfather Saul and killing his father Jonathan cause him, at the hand of his nurse, to flee, to run. And not only does he become lame in his feet, but he also loses everything that was his as part of being royalty. And, you know, you would look at that and you go, wow, you know, that's a really bad deal to lose everything that came with royalty. But in the culture, to be lame in the feet, to be handicapped, if you will, it's even worse. You can't work. You can't provide for yourself. You have to live off the assistance of others. And frankly, people that had disabilities in these days were not treated well at all. So Mephibosheth, he leaves the royal household there at 5 years old. He has to go live with another family, and he goes and lives in a place called a thing of nothingness, a thing of naught. He's been stripped of everything. He's lost everything. There is no hope for the future. There are no opportunities for somebody in his condition. And you know what? He better lay low, depending how his mind set is. He better lay low, because if he raises his head too high as being a descendant of Saul, there may be those who think, hey, he's trying to take over the kingdom or trying to reestablish something to himself. So even more challenges for him. So look at how David responds to this in verse 5. King David sent and brought him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lo Debar. So he goes and he brings him out. So he didn't just page him to the castle, you know, set off his beeper, call his cell phone, you know, and anything like this. They went and got him. They brought him out, you know. And I don't know how that would look. Did they send a chariot? Did they send a litter? Did they send a palanquin, you know, the chair that's on the poles and the guys carry, you know, because he can't walk. But they went and they brought him out. And now when Mephibosheth, notice the text says and reminds us, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, the grandson of Saul, had come to David. He fell on his face and prostrated himself. So in his bodily action, we see what could be the orientation of his heart and of his mind. There he puts himself on his face before the king. And David said, "Mephibosheth?" And he answered, "Here is your servant." And so now we get to see the heart. We get to see the position of the body face down in front of the king. We get to see out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. We get to see the heart. Here is not a servant, not here is not the servant. Here is your servant, David. And so David said to him, "Do not fear." You know what? Don't worry, Mephibosheth. It's all going to be okay. Again, I like this because in David, a man who spends so much time with God, we see what comes out of his life and what comes out of his mouth is those same kind of actions with God. Man, when one of God's angels shows up, when a Christophany shows up, when the Lord appears on the scene, the first words out of his mouth are, "Hey, don't fear. It's going to be okay." And David, he's the beneficiary of this. He has experienced this before. And he says to Mephibosheth, "Hey, you know what? Don't fear." So first thing, right off the bat, no worries. Don't be afraid. Everything's going to be okay. And then he gives to him three things. Number one, I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake. So that's that kindness we saw in verse 1, kindness for Jonathan's sake, and in verse 3, that I may show the kindness of God. So number one, I'm going to show you kindness because of who your dad is. Number two, I am going to restore to you all the land of Saul, your grandfather. So you're going to go from Lo Debar, having nothing, having naught, to experiencing, number one, my kindness and the kindness of God. Number two, you're going to go from having nothing to having restored to you all the land of Saul, your grandfather. Now, that doesn't mean the nation of Israel. Each person in Israel, they were the people of the land. Each person had land apportioned to them. This is my family's plot of land. Right here. This is the family plot of land. Okay, Mephibosheth, you're going to have the land that was assigned to your grandfather, Saul, that is going to be restored to you. You had lost it. We don't know how, but you had lost it. You didn't have it. It's going to be restored to you, number two. And number three, you shall eat bread at my table continually. Now, there's some discussion on this, and we're just going to deal with it right now so that as we begin to wind up, we can don't have to come back and deal with it again. But there's some discussion, hey, does this mean that, you know, when David comes downstairs in the morning and has his marmalade on his English muffin, Mephibosheth is sitting there with his cup of hot tea and dry toast, and, you know, they're doing morning devotions together at the breakfast table. And there are some people who say, yeah, that's what that is. There are others who say, and it's just my personal opinion, I tend to kind of look at it like this, that the idea was, is that when there was a state dinner, when there were visiting dignitaries, when there was going to be a religious feast, when the family gathered together to celebrate this, that, or the other thing, there was a table, there was a seat reserved at that festive table for Mephibosheth. So maybe he lived sometime there at the royal household, sometime he lived at his own house, you know, there on the property that had belonged to his father Saul. But when the whole family gathered together, when David was there with his whole family, and when there were the dignitaries visiting and this sort of thing, state dinner, whatever, Mephibosheth was right in the middle. That's really a beautiful picture, isn't it? Man, here it is. You know, we've seen pictures of the state dinners at the White House, you know, and there's like, you know, 6 forks and 15 spoons and 3 champagne glasses, you know, and Nancy Reagan's china, just dated myself, and, you know, there we all are, and it's going to be this big feast, you know, and in the middle of it, there's Mephibosheth, lame feet and all. Oh, that's really incredible. Three things. Don't fear. I'm going to show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake. I'm going to restore to you all the land of your Saul, your grandfather, and you shall eat bread at my table continually. And we see the perspective of Mephibosheth, and he bowed himself and said, he couldn't last. And he bowed himself and said, watch this phrasing here. What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? This hammered me to the heart this week. Because Mephibosheth doesn't say, who is your servant? He says, what is your servant? And see, one of the terrible things that happens is when we marginalize and we minimalize individuals, we turn them from being whose into being what do you do? How much are you worth? What have you done for me lately? What's wrong with you? Instead of who? Who? You're my brother or sister in Christ. Who? You've been redeemed by my Jesus. Who? You've been created in the image of God. Who, son or daughter, are you? Whose mom or dad are you? Whose brother or sister are you? The Nazis were able to exterminate the Jews because they turned the Jews into what's instead of who's. They stripped them of their importance as human beings, as individuals, and they made them be what's. They were the cause of the problem. the world's ills fell on the shoulders of the Jews. And don't kid yourself, the perspective of Satan in this cruel world hasn't changed in the least. So Mephibosheth, his perspective has been sculpted by possibly his treatment of those around him. Whatever the case, his perspective is, what is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? Can I ask you something? Does a dead dog have any value at all? No. Does a dead dog have any use?
No.
And there we begin to see Mephibosheth's perspective on his life. That he's a what? That he has no value? And he lives in a place called Lodabar, a thing of naught or nothing. Does this not make David's kindness to him even greater? Does this not even just contrast the kindness of God toward him in such a more powerful way? I think it does. What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? Well, David doesn't even respond to this. Verse 9, and the king called to Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, I have given to your master's son, that is Mephibosheth, all that belonged to Saul and to all his house. You, therefore, and your sons and your servants shall work the land for him, and you shall bring in the harvest, that your master's son may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's son, shall eat bread at my table always. Look at this. You will work the land for him. You're going to work the land for him. You're going to take care of him. Man, how sweet is that? Mephibosheth, the one who's lame in his feet, the one whose perspective is that he's a dead dog, the one who lives in a place that is of nothingness. No, no, no. He's going to be taken care of. And look at, lest we go, oh, Ziba, how are you going to do that? Oh, that's going to be terrible. We're told, now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. So that's a pretty good size number of farmhands there to take care of Ziba and Mephibosheth. And Ziba said to the king, verse 11, according to all that my lord the king has commanded his servant, so will your servant do. We want to remember Ziba. We want to remember his heart right here. Because in 2 Samuel 16, he is going to stab, figuratively, Mephibosheth in the back and try and position himself in a much better way with King David. So at the moment here, he's okay. But, you know, there's something else going on there. As for Mephibosheth, said the king, he shall eat at my table like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. And all who dwelt in the house of Ziba were servants of Mephibosheth. And so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he ate continually at the king's table. And look at the testimony of the Holy Spirit, the conclusion of the story. And he was lame in both his feet. How incredible is it that as we come into this life, we're not just lame in our feet. The Bible says that we are lost, that we are dead in our trespasses and sins. In our trespasses and sins, we're dead, we're wiped out. And the Holy Spirit, he comes and he calls us and he draws us into a relationship with God the Father. Because God the Father and Jesus Christ the Son, they've made this covenant, they've made this agreement. This is what salvation is going to look like. This is the solution to the sin problem. And God is not willing that any should perish, but all should come to eternal life. And the heart of God the Father is that he would desire that each and every one of us would see his kindness toward his son, that each and every one of us would see the kindness of his son toward us, and that we wouldn't just scratch and scrape our way through this life on into a hellish eternity, but we'd enter into a walk and a relationship with him, the banquet of love that is ours through Christ Jesus the Son. That we would enter into a relationship with him where we would be taken care of, where we would be cared for, where our bread would be provided for the day, where our clothes would be provided for our backs, where a shelter would be provided over our head, where we would be taken care of by God our Father. and he was lame in both his feet. The fact that he was lame, the fact that he was hurt, the fact that society looked on him as being less than or least of others, made totally no effect on David in his showing kindness toward him for Jonathan's sake, or showing the kindness of God toward him. I would challenge and I would encourage us to be those individuals, to be like David in our walk and our relationship with God. Would we have our eyes open? Would we have our hearts open? How could we show the kindness of God to those in our community, to those in our circle of influence, to those that are lame in their feet, so to speak, those who are lost and dead in their trespasses and sin? Who is it that goes into the jail to tell those people about Jesus? Who is it that goes into the nursing home to counsel those people as they prepare to step from this world into an everlasting eternity? Who is it that goes into the veterans hospital? Who is it that ministers to our first responders? Who is it that checks on those who are in the twilight years of their life and maybe living in their home and just needing an extra and helping hand? Who is it that looks for those with the lame feet in our society that they can show the kindness of the Lord Jesus Christ and the kindness of God to those individuals? I'll tell you who it is. It's us Christians. It's each and every one of us here this morning. We close with this from Psalm 36. Psalm 36 says this: "How precious is your loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings. They are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your pleasures. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Oh, continue your loving kindness to those who know you, in your righteousness to the upright in heart." Father, thank you that your loving kindness is without end. And Father, it's without end, we would be reminded, not just so that we would never run out of it, that it'd never come to an end in our life, but Lord, your loving kindness to us is without end, that it would flow as through a channel through our life into the lives of those that are around us. Father, that we would have those helping hands, those helping hearts, those eyes that are sensitive to see how we can minister to those that are not just lame in their feet, but they're lost and they're dead in their trespasses and sins, separated and enemies of yours. And yet, Father, you have sent your Son for their sin. You have sent your Son to be their Savior. And Father, that we would carry to them the good news, the gospel, the salvation that is found in your Son, Christ Jesus. Father, thank you for the example and the illustration that David is to us, Lord, this morning as we look at your word, this man with a heart after yours. Father, that we would find ourselves looking on at the truths of his administration, the truths of his reigning, the truths of his desiring to show kindness. And Father, we would seek your heart for us. Lord, how you would want to mold and shape our lives, that our lives would be decent, they would be in order, there would be structure. And Lord, that from that foundation in you, Lord, we would be able to reach out to others and minister to others around us. Lord, give us grace for this great week coming up, Lord, for the Lord, that we just have eyes open to see, Lord, how you would want to use us in the lives of others. Father, that you give us hearts of servants, that, Father, you'd give us hearts of wanting to bless, and that, Father, you'd give us new and realized ways, Lord, not where we'd fall in love with your law, not where we would seek to fulfill your law, but, Lord, we would rejoice in your loving kindness, and, Father, we would enjoy your great grace which you've showered down upon us. Father, thank you so much for these things and for so much more. And, Lord, we just praise and thank you that in this closing time, Lord, we can lift up our voices in praise and worship to you.